This conference will now be recorded.
Good morning, everybody. It is good to be here in the house of the Lord today in this nice cool month of July in La Mesa, Texas. I tell you what, I'm not ready for summer to be over, but I am ready for the 108 degree weather to be over. It's just stifling, but at least it cools off in the late evening and early mornings here. We were in Dallas. We went and visited my daughter in Fort Worth this weekend. And I mean, 10 o'clock, it's still 98 degrees and 87% humidity. So praise God for West Texas. So, but I am ready for it to cool off. I'm just going to open today with just announcements. Right now, just we're in our summer schedule. We're not having our Wednesday night Bible study or fellowship meal. We'll be starting that back up when school starts. So that's really the only announcement that we have. And then I want to read a verse today for y'all for our call to worship. This is a verse that comes out of Habakkuk 2, and it's Habakkuk 2:4. And this is a verse that Paul uses a lot when he talks about living our life by faith. But it says, "Look at the proud, they trust in themselves, and their lives are crooked. But the righteous will live by their faith in God." And that is so much the key to our relationship with Christ, is living by faith. You know, not being like the righteous and trying to live on ourselves and what we think and trusting in ourselves, but trusting in God. And I just think if I can remind myself of anything every morning, it's just keep on trusting, Al. Keep on trusting. Trust in God. Keep faith. Keep going in that direction. And that was what I was thinking about this morning as I was thinking about our call to worship. But the righteous will live by their faith to God. The righteous will live by their faith in God. Father God, as we come together today to worship you and praise you, Lord, we just pray that we can do that, that we can live a life of faith where we don't rely on our own understanding and what we think is right, but we lean towards you and your guidance in our life, Lord, that we may have faith in you and what you have done, what you are doing, and what you will do, Lord. Lord, just help us today as we gather together to hear from your word and to worship and to fellowship one with another, Lord. And we just pray that you just bless this time, that your presence be thick in this place. It's in Jesus Christ's wonderful and holy name that we can and do pray. Amen. As you can tell, Hav is out of town. He has a wedding this week. He's going to a wedding, so we're just going to go ahead and Lonnie has picked out some songs that we're going to sing. And this is crazy. The screen is also broken. It won't go down, so we're not going to have words. But Lonnie picked out songs that hopefully we all know. And the screen should be fixed. The next Sunday. So Hav's been working on that. So apologize that we don't have any music and we don't have a screen. But man, God's here, and we just trust that he'll reveal himself today. So go ahead and lead us, Lonnie, from the back.
My God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. how great thou art, how great thou art, when Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Amen, amen. Y'all can go ahead and be seated. Thank you, Randy, for leading that for us today. It's always nice to have Randy Travis with us in our midst. Yes, amen. Amen. But we're going to share our joys and concerns right now. I know that we have some. Brad and Candy texted me this morning, and Brad's been suffering really bad this summer with heat exhaustion. He's had to go to the hospital 2 or 3 times. With heat exhaustion, and their air conditioning is out in their house right now, so they're having to stay in a hotel here in Lubbock. So be praying for them. And they also, their cat got out when they had having to go back and forth from the hotel and the house and everything. And so Candy's upset that her cat's gone. So just, I told them we'd be praying for Brad and that they find their cat, and just pray that he gets over this, all this heat exhaustion and stuff. So it's tough. But, and Lonnie, you shared earlier, what prayer concern did you share with me earlier? Okay, Aaron's grandfather. Okay, Aaron's mom's dad's grandfather. Just be in prayer for him. Be in prayer for him. I also need to remember Cruz, as he's continuing to go through his cancer, his ordeal with cancer, and we just pray for him and pray for the family. Pray for my mom. I don't know, COVID has kind of kicked back up again, and it has gotten in my mom's assisted living place. So right now they're kind of locking everything down to where they have to eat in their rooms and all that. So I know some of them had to go to the hospital, and it's really my mom. Every day is a new day for my mom, so I have to explain to her every day why she can't leave her room and why. So she's just having a, let me unplug that. So she's having a hard time. She does better when she can go out and talk to people and communicate. And of course, she can't do that right now. So we should pray for those folks that are sick and pray that it gets over pretty quick. Any other joys or concerns out there today? Any birthday? Yes, sir.
I went into my favorite guy there and I said, you know, you look really old. Of course, he looked at me and said, well, you're a good one to be caught. Before I don't look very good anymore. But anyway, he said, well, how did you know to come by? He said, you haven't been by in 60 days. I said, I will. And he said, well, 3 days ago, my son tried to commit suicide. Mm. And And I said, well, nothing. And I said nothing. And he said, well, let me tell you, God, it seems that the wife decided to leave him after 3 years. He just lost it. So he got in his pickup and headed to Amarillo. This guy knew the DPS officer lived down the street from there. He called him, and they actually caught the guy at the Palladura King with the gun in the hand and the pickup. Stopped. And he said, you know, it just really tells on you when it's the only son you have, 34 years old. And I said, well, I want you to know something. There are at least six of us at Northridge Methodist Church Sunday, or more, that will lift up your son in prayer. And he said, well, just don't mention my name. And I said, we won't, but we'll direct it to Dillard Department Store and or something.
But yeah.
It must be a tragic thing when his son has never been in trouble and gets married at older age and then just snaps. I know that there's like that in the world, but it just happened to me.
Mm-hmm.
And I was so impressed that he would tell me about it when I don't really even know him.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, you'll direct that to Dillard's.
All right. As for those of y'all online that might not have been able to hear that, Jim's friend at Dillard's, his son, they had to intervene and stop him from attempting suicide this weekend. So we'll just be praying for Dillard's man and his son. That's hard. Any other prayer concerns or joys out there? All right. Let's go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer then. Father God, we just come to you right now. And Lord, first and foremost, we just lift up the gentleman at Dillard's and his son who is going through a hard time, Lord. Lord, we pray for him. We pray for his son. We pray that, Lord, that your presence be with him in such a way that he understands his identity and who he is. Lord, that he doesn't have to rely on a relationship with someone else, Lord, but that you are all that he needs and that you can get him through this, Lord. Lord, we pray for wisdom for all that are involved. And Lord, we just pray for your power at that time. Lord, we lift up Brad as he's having a hard time dealing with heat stroke and as they've lost the air conditioning in their house. And we just pray that he can take care of himself to where he doesn't have to go back into the hospital. We pray for them as they're getting their house fixed. And Lord, we pray for their cat that they lost. Lord, we lift up my mom and just everything that's going on where she lives and those that have come in contact with COVID and they're sick. Lord, we pray for healing there. We pray for protection and we pray for wisdom for those people that are running those places like that. And Lord, we just pray that that they can just the folks that live there can find stuff to do and to have good mental health in this as well. Lord, we pray for Aaron's grandfather and we just pray for him as he's not doing well. Lord, we just pray for him. And just ask that you be with him. Lord, we love you and we praise you. And Lord, we just lift these concerns to you. And Lord, we pray for those that are out traveling. We pray for Hob as he's going to a wedding. And we pray for those that are out on vacation and visiting family and friends. And just pray that you watch over them as they travel to and from. It's in Christ's name that we can and do pray. Amen. I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward as we continue to worship with our tithes and offerings. Amen. And you're more than welcome to give here. And we also, if you're watching online, you can go to our website and there's a donate button, a give button up there, and you can donate there. And or you can always send your gifts in to Miss Sue, and she'll make sure that those are taken care of. And Lord, we just appreciate y'all's support of this church and what God is doing here. So, y'all want me to pray or y'all going to pray? Tommy's got it this morning.
thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Because you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. This love's so undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me deeper still.
Amen, amen. What a great reminder of who Christ is. He is perfect in all of his ways. He is a good, good father. And thank you, Lonnie, for picking that one out as well. That was a great one. That was a great one. Well, the message I want to share today, just as last week we started talking in the book of James, And as we looked in James, we just talked about the importance of treating others in the way that they should be treated, and not having favorites. And we looked at the word favorite, that favorite is someone that has a face like mine, you know, that somebody that sees things the way that I see them, that look like I do, and that James instructs us to not have favorites. And today we're going to continue to be in the book of James, and we're going to be looking at the part of the book of James that deals with our tongue and what we say. And I think if you're like me and you think about the things that we say, well, they can get you into trouble and hurry. You know, we can just be spontaneous and say something that we shouldn't, and well, it'll get us in trouble. But before we go there, I just wanted to give a couple of stories before we got started. But, and we've been traveling a lot lately, just having things that we needed to do. And of course, I have to drive up to Amarillo all the time and see my mom, and, you know, coming back and forth between La Mesa and here. And there's one thing that Jody has said to me numerous times over the past couple weeks as we've been driving, is she says, look, there's where a fire was on the side of the road. And or she would say, hey, there's a fire. And she doesn't mean to say there's a fire, because the fire's already gone, but there's evidence of a fire. You can tell when you go by and all of a sudden there's this big burnt patch on the side of the road, or sometimes it even goes out into the field and it's even bigger. And you know, with the conditions in West Texas right now, with it being so dry and with not getting very much rain at all, the conditions out there are ripe for a fire. And, you know, since July the 4th, since Independence Day was just a couple of weeks ago, there's been a lot of fireworks. And just last night, when we were driving around town last night, we saw people still shooting fireworks off. You know, they were shooting fireworks off. I guess they just bought a bunch and didn't finish on the 4th, and they're wrapping them up. But you know, when you think about those fires that start on the side of the road, some of them might have been started by fireworks, but most of them, you know, something happens to a car, a tire blows out, and a big truck, a tire blows out on the back, and all of a sudden the rim starts hitting or something, and sparks start going, and a spark or a hot piece of metal will go off and sit on the side of the road and smolder. Then the next thing you know, you got a fire. Or sometimes it's because we just do something that we're not supposed to do. Somebody might be smoking a cigarette or something like that, and they just throw that cigarette butt out the window, and it doesn't land on the asphalt. It goes over to the side, and same thing, it begins to smolder, and this fire starts, and the fire starts, and it begins to get bigger and bigger. And then, of course, there's always the things that we make mistakes, or we do things intentionally. I know some people that used to just burn stuff just because they like to watch it burn, and then the next thing you know, it'd get out of control. But when I was a little kid once, we went out to the east side of Amarillo, way outside of town, to where this Caterpillar plant was, Caterpillar lot was, where they sold Caterpillar work equipment. One of my parents' friends, dad, was the manager of that place, and they had a really big cleaned off area where they drove all the Caterpillar bulldozers and stuff, and we were shooting fireworks out there. Well, right next to us was a field, and sure enough, when we were out there, we were shooting fireworks off, and one of the things fell over, or one of the balls went over, and the next thing you know, we got a fire. And it wasn't just a little fire, it was a pretty big fire. It goes from nothing to pretty big in a hurry. It got to where the fire department had to come out there and to put that out. And I remember my sister, I was sitting on this tarp, you know, just sitting there. I was kind of I don't remember how old I was, elementary school. My sister just runs over, she grabs that tarp and jerks it off with me and everything on it. And we just all tumble off, and she goes and gives that tarp to my dad. My dad was out there fighting that fire. Well, there's this little kid, his name was Brian, that was with us. He was my age. Well, he thought this was a great opportunity to have more fun. So he'd go out to where the fire was, and he was taking bottle rockets back when they were legal, and he was throwing these bottle rockets into the fire. So, I mean, he was just making it worse, right? He thought it was funny, though, because, you know, you just throw these bottle rockets in there, and they'd go off. And, well, his dad did not appreciate that when he found out what little Brian was doing, throwing those ball rockets into that. But man, James says in Scripture that our tongue is much like a spark, a fire, that we can say something and it can get out of control in a hurry and it can do lots of damage. As I was thinking about this today and over the last couple of days, the damage that can be done with our tongue, the largest fire in the history of California was started by a guy that made a mistake. He was trying to do a controlled burn, burning some trash on his land, and the next thing you know, he made a mistake. He didn't maintain it well, and it began to spread. And it ended up burning something like 400,000 acres, destroying 285 homes before it was finally contained. And this guy made a mistake. You know, and that's the same thing it is with our mouths. And when we say something, sometimes when we don't think about it, it gets out of control in a hurry. And sometimes it goes so far that it destroys homes. It destroys houses. And man, that's not what we want to do, right? We don't want to say things that keep going. You know, I have friends, I know folks that have been estranged with their kids, separated from their kids for years and years. And if I remember and I talk to them and I ask them, it can always go back to some words that were said, some communication that went wrong, some bad things that were said. And man, homes are being destroyed because of the words that we have. You know, there's this character that I grew up with, Smokey Bear. You know, what does Smokey Bear says? It's up to you. Only you can prevent forest fires. Only you can prevent. He gives this warning. Only you can prevent forest fires. And I think in Scripture, God does this a lot through Scripture. He says, warning, warning. Hey, you need to watch what you say. Only you can prevent these forest fires. Only you can prevent what comes out of your mouth. And the damage that will come from you. You know, I think about that bear, that big cuddly bear, you know, giving us this warning about our mouths. But, you know, bears are dangerous too, right? Bears are dangerous too. There's something about seeing this big cuddly bear saying, hey, but bears are dangerous too. For those of you who go up to Rio Doce all the time, I remember once I was up there at Alto, staying at a pretty nice house in Alto Country Club. Girlfriend of mine, not this one, sorry, Jody, but a girlfriend of mine, their grandparents had a pretty nice house up there, and I just remember one morning I walk outside into the garage, and there's this bear in the garage with me, had the trash can tipped over, and he's just eating breakfast, and boy, I turned around, and I shut that door, I got out of there in a hurry. But there's some folks that look at bears, and they think bears are tame, and they're our friends, that they're like Smokey Bear. One of the worst stories I ever heard, and this was probably 20 or 30 years ago when I was a young man, I heard about this family at Yellowstone. They put peanut butter on the side of their kid's face and held it out the window to try to get a picture of a bear licking the peanut butter off the kid's face. I would be like, warning, warning, that's a bear. You know, and of course, it didn't end up well. And bears don't lick. You know, and the kid survived and everything, but it was a horrific, you know, experience for the family and for the kid. We have to be careful. There are warnings out there for us to be careful. And Scripture gives us so many of them. In Proverbs 18, it says this. It says, the tongue can bring death or life. For those who love to talk will reap the consequences. The tongue can bring life or death. You know, I think that's just such a wise thing to know. Our tongue can bring death, and our tongue can also bring life. You know, warning, warning, don't start a fire. You know, I was in communication with somebody very, very dear to me that has entered into a new relationship, and one of the things this person said in comparing this relationship I guess to other relationships that from the past or something, but it was something like this. This new person, whenever he says something wrong or says something that hurts me, I tell him about it. He apologizes profusely, and he makes sure to never do it again. And when comparing that to past relationships, this is a vast improvement. Because we're not perfect. We're going to make mistakes. But only you can prevent forest fires. And I think this young man is practicing that and knowing that if you say something that you shouldn't say and it's brought to your attention, apologize profusely and do the best that you can to not do it again. That the tongue can bring death or the tongue can bring life. And in that situation, the tongue is bringing life to that relationship. The tongue is bringing life to that individual by what it is saying and by what it is not saying. You know, it's just this huge warning that we have. When we turn over to James, and we won't look at it, well, y'all can't look at it on the screen yet, but sorry. But we're going to be in James chapter 2. For those of you online, you're going to be able to see it. And I am having a hard time there, James. James chapter 3. Sorry, my bad. James chapter 3. I'm just going to start reading at verse 1. The verse that we are sharing on the screen doesn't come down to verse 5, but I think the verses leading up to it. It says, "Dear brothers and sisters, not many of you should become teachers in the church, for we who teach will be judged more strictly. Indeed, we all make many mistakes." All right? We all make mistakes. And in this context, we're talking about things that we are teaching, things that we are saying. Indeed, we all make many mistakes. We all, not just some of us, not him, not that person, but we all make many mistakes. Because if we could control our tongues, we would be perfect and could also control ourselves in every other way. So he's saying, you know, this is tough. If you can control your tongue, then you're going to also can control your whole self, and we'd be perfect in all that we can do. But we can make a horse go wherever we want by means of a small bit in their mouth. You know, a horse is a very big animal. It has a very small mouth. But when we control the mouth of a horse, we can control where that horse goes. Very much in the same way. If we can control our mouth, we can take our direction in the direction in which we want to go. And a small rudder on a huge ship can make a huge ship turn wherever the pilot chooses to go, even though the winds are strong. If you ever have been out on a big sailing ship, the rudder is down there at the bottom, and it controls things in the water and the current. It can turn the boat, and the winds blow in one way. But that it amazes me that in a sailing ship, you can sail against the wind just because of the way the rudder goes and the way you're harnessing the wind. It's still putting pressure up there, but you can go against the wind. It's a very powerful thing. Yet it's a very small thing, just as the tongue is the small thing in our mouth, in a small part of who we are. The tongue is the same way. The tongue is a small thing that makes grand speeches. But a tiny spark can set a forest on fire. But the tiny spark can set a forest on fire. Just like we were mentioning earlier, this tiny spark can set a forest on fire, which ends up in so much damage and devastation, and it can sometimes even eventually go to where a home is damaged and destroyed. Among all the parts of the body, the tongue is a flame of fire. It is a whole world of wickedness corrupting your entire body. It can set your whole life on fire, for it is set on fire by hell itself. I mean, that's a pretty good one there. Is that your tongue can set the whole world on fire, and it is set on fire by hell itself. You know, so there are times, as we saw in the Proverbs, there are times that the tongue and what we say can bring life. And there's also times in what we say that the tongue can bring death. And I believe that when the tongue is bringing death is when it is set on fire by hell itself. You know, we are, something is going on in our brain. We are being tempted to believe something that is untrue or not right. And boy, we just lash out. And sometimes it might be true. It might be true and what we share, but the way in which we say it might be motivated more by ill intentions and how we might be trying to hurt somebody back because they hurt us. People contain all kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, and fish, but no one can tame the tongue. Well, that's it. That's the end of the sermon. You know, it is causing death and destruction. It comes from hell itself, but we can't tame it. So let's just go ahead and go home. But if you read through James, James's whole message is that there's a lot of stuff that we can't do. But through faith and humbleness in Christ and humbling ourselves and trusting in Christ, Christ can change us. Christ can change us in the way that we see things, the way that we act, and the way that we do. But man can tame the tongue, is restless and evil, full of deadly poison. Deadly poison. I mean, these are some very strict warnings that we have. Sometimes it praises our Lord and Father, and sometimes it curses those who have been made in the image of God. You know, that's a, I mean, to me, that's a Sunday, Monday kind of thing. Sunday, that tongue is praising God. And on Monday, it's cursing those who are made in the image of God. And boy, that's not God's design. That's not God's design for us on how we are supposed to use this tongue. The tongue is a very powerful thing. And it's not something that we should just, in this building, in this context, when we see these, sing these wonderful worship songs, that it should be something that is praising God. And then tomorrow, when somebody does something wrong to us, all of a sudden we begin cursing someone that is made in the image of God. And so blessing and cursing can point out of the same mouth. Surely, my brothers and sisters, this is not right. Does a spring of water bubble out both fresh water and bitter water? No, it doesn't. A spring bubbles out fresh water, and that's where we are going in this. Does a fig tree produce olives or a grapevine produce figs? No, you can't draw fresh water from a salty spring. So in this lesson, there is no man that can tame its own tongue. There's no man that can tame his own tongue, but if the source of that is good, and the source of that is good, then what flows out of it is good. So I've got three things, there's 3 points to this sermon that I think we can help rely that our source is of fresh water and that we're not spewing poison. And the three things are, as I mentioned earlier in our call to worship, you know, we have to trust God. We have to fully trust God. We have to fully trust in Him, make Him Lord over our life. The second thing is that we have to really be careful what ends up in our minds and our hearts. Because what ends up in our minds and our hearts are so often what comes spewing out. What comes out of our minds and our hearts is what spews out of us, because our heart is the deepest identity of who it is. And the way I understand it is that we hear something, we comprehend it, we think about it, and as we think about it, it becomes part of our mind. And as it becomes part of our mind and we put it into action and we believe it, then it kind of sinks down into our heart and it becomes a part of who we truly are and how we live our lives. And the danger doesn't come from what we hear. The danger comes from what we think and believe, and it sinks down into our heart. So the second part is we need to control what we think and we believe. We need to be vigilant and pray and try the best that we can that what we think and believe lines up with God. And the third thing is that we have to be very careful on what comes out. On what comes out. We have to guard our tongue and make sure that what comes out lines up with what comes in. So I think a prayer for us on a daily basis, I think this is always good prayer. You know, Father God, I trust in you today. Lord, I trust in you, and I give myself to you. Lord, help me dwell on the things that are of you. Help me dwell on the things that are truthful. Lord, help me dwell on the things that are truthful, and let me live my life from those. And the things that come out of my mouth and the actions that come out of my body, Lord, let them line up with those truths. You know, that prayer of reminding ourselves that God is the one that's in control, and that we have faith in him and we rely on him. We humble ourselves and rely on him. And Lord, help us focus on the things that are of you. And Lord, as we focus on those things that are of you, may the things that are produced from us be something that is glorifying to you and of you. You know, it all centers around us putting our faith and trust in Christ and becoming that new creation, because we can't change ourselves at all. But when Christ comes inside of us and we become this new creation and we are now a follower of Christ, we are baptismal, we are born again, we are son or daughter of the Most High King, he can begin to change us, make us, and mold us more and more into his image. And I have seen this time and time again of people that were grouchy and grumpy and mean-spirited and angry, and as they came into a relationship with Christ, it was just this miraculous change in their heart, to where their words actually changed and their heart actually changed, to where they began to treat people differently. So that's the first thing, is that we must constantly be reminding ourselves of our faith in Christ and our faith in God, and saying, Lord, I can't do it. No man can change and control their tongue, but Lord, you can. No man can change themselves and make themselves good or better, but Lord, you can. And then we fight this battle in our mind over what is good and what the truth is. Okay, what is good and what the truth is. And I have a very distinct worldview. I have a distinct worldview that is centered around Christ and the Bible and the biblical narrative. I know that I see things differently than the majority of the world, because I'm a Christ follower. You know, I see things that God is on this rescue mission to rescue those who are all those that were created in his image, and his end goal is that he rescues them and they are brought back into his purpose for all of eternity. And that God is on this mission, this redemptive mission, to redeem his creation unto himself. And in scripture, from Genesis 1 to Revelation 20 and 21, there's this wonderful narrative. There's this wonderful story of what God has done, what God is doing, and what God will do in this narrative of his redeeming us, his creation unto himself. So that's the center of my worldview. That's the center of my worldview. So everything that I do, most everything that I do comes out of that biblical understanding of who God is, who I am in the eyes of God, and who the world is in the eyes of God, and what God is doing. And I understand that most people don't see it that way. There are some people that do, but most people don't. So when I interact with people in the real world, when I interact with people outside the walls of this church, when I interact with people that are out there, I'm going to have an unbelievable amount of opportunities to hear things that I don't agree with. Right? Is that true? I mean, we're going to have unbelievable amount of opportunities to hear things, to have conversations with people about things that I don't believe and I don't understand. And I believe that I should fight very hard, or try very hard, to hold on to that truth and to make sure that I understand things through the truth of who God is and what God has done, what he is doing, and what he will do, and how I fit into that. So I think that that's really important, that I stick with the Word of God. I stick with the Bible. I stick with how God has revealed himself, is revealing himself, will reveal himself. And this is the way this is the truth that I hold on to. And those other things that aren't truth, that might go against what I believe, I need to work really hard to not grasp those into my mind to where I begin to believe them, and they begin to sink down into my heart to where then I begin to live them out, okay? So that's where I need to guard myself. Now, here's the biggest test, I think, in guarding your mind and making sure that you are believing what is biblical and believing how God reveals us. That's very important. We fight like a bear to make sure that we keep that in strength, you know, but we don't fight with the people that disagree with us or have other worldviews. Our calling for them is that we enter into conversation with them, we dialogue with them, we love them. It's almost like we fight like a bear to keep what's right in our mind, but we're almost like a teddy bear when it comes with how we treat other people. So often in the world, I've seen more forest fires started in families, in communities, in countries, because the way good intentioned people have tried to fight like a bear to hold on to what they believe and what they believe individually, that when it comes across to when they're communicating with their kids, their families, their neighbors, you know, whoever it may be, that they do it in such a way and they say it in such a way that a fire starts and that fire begins just this incredible amount of destruction. I truly believe that we can hold on to what we know is right in Christ and still be able to love others in the midst of that. I do. I have a friend named D.G. Hollums who is like a big teddy bear. I mean, he's just this big teddy bear. He has a beard about this big, and he loves everybody. He just loves everybody. This past weekend, not yesterday, but the weekend before, he was in Roswell, New Mexico for the Alien Fest, right? They have this alien conference once a year. Maybe twice a year. It's a moneymaker, but they have this thing where people come up from all over the place and they do all this alien stuff, right? They do all this alien stuff, and it's just this whole subculture of people. I'm not into aliens, but there's a whole bunch of them there. We drove through it last week and there were people everywhere. Well, my friend DG, he gets dressed up as if you're familiar with Star Wars, and they have the Jedi, and they sometimes they wear these robes and all this. Well, he gets dressed up as a Jedi from Star Wars, which fits in really good with aliens, right? That means there's people out there, there's other things. And he goes around, and he gets his picture made, you know, doing stuff like this and holding a lightsaber and all this stuff with all these little kids, People that I promised, he's a pastor. He is an ordained elder in the United Methodist Church, and his worldview is such that it probably doesn't line up with a bunch of people that believe in aliens and other beings outside of the world. But he goes around, and he gets his picture made, and he does all this stuff, and he loves other people. And there's this picture that he posted on Facebook last week of his experience there in Roswell. And there's this little girl, and he's like doing something like this, like looking at her, and this girl's face is just like, oh my goodness, I've never seen something as cool as he is. And her eyes are bright, and she just thinks she is interacting with somebody from a movie. And he looks up, and she is just all in. I think in how he treated her, I think she would have trusted him just about anything. I mean, her eyes were that way. And friends, I think DG for me is a wonderful example of how we treat people that might not see the world the same way we do. But we love them in such a way that they began to trust us so that we can speak into their life, that we can speak into their life. You know, I have friends, parents that are parents of children, from parents that are dead and gone right now, to people that are in their 90s, all the way down to, I know people that are in their 20s that have kids. And I've seen example after example after example of how parents have either, one, done it right, or B, two, done it wrong, and how they've interacted with their kids and spoke the truth. You know, a guy that used to teach my Sunday school, our Sunday school class, when we first got married, his son began to start making some poor choices. Just got into a lifestyle that I didn't probably jive with what his dad wanted him to do. And his dad, I remember his dad sitting down to talk to him and to tell him the truth. And man, it went over like a lead balloon. Lead balloon. And it completely severed this relationship. The kid got in his car, he drove to the West Coast, to San Francisco, and just started living this lifestyle and never called his dad again. His dad never called him again. 7 years later, he's dead. He died of AIDS. And I look back at that, and I go, man, is there something that could have been different about how that was handled, to where the love and the communication could have still been there, right? And then I have other friends, same situation. They just sit their kids down and say, man, no matter what, I love you. I don't agree with this. It goes against my worldview and what I believe, but I love you. I love you, and I will never not love you. And there was something in the way that it was communicated from the mind to the heart, that what we believe was more important than how we loved people, when it can be the same. We love people based off of what we believe, and we hope the best for it. So that last part of the prayer is, Lord, then what comes out of our mouth? May it not be something that starts a forest fire. Or may it not just be something that sparks a fire on the side of the road. Because our tongues, they bring life. The words that we speak can bring life to people. And the words that we speak can also bring death to people. And man, that's my goal for y'all, is that I want to believe what I believe. And I want it to be of God. But I never want what I believe to cause pain or separation or the opposite of God's mission on this earth. I don't ever want to be used as an excuse for somebody to not try to put their faith and trust in what God's doing in their life. Words are powerful. Words are powerful. You know, yesterday when we were saying goodbye to my daughter in Arlington, you know, I get out and I'm just like, I love you, hey, bye. You know, she's taller than me, so I'm like, hey, I love you, bye, you know, all this. And then Jody has to one-up me. So Jody one-ups me, and she just holds my daughter and just holds her and whisper in her ear, and my daughter's crying and all this. And I'm sorry, going, well, she's speaking a whole lot more life into this situation than I was. You know, so I had to get one more in, which I said, come here, you know, I love you too. I'm not going to cry, but I love you too. But in that moment, daughters, they go through good and bad times, right? They're confused. They do good, you know. And right now my daughter's in one of those, oh, I don't know what's going on in my life kind of things. And Jody just spoke life. Just spoke life. And reassured her, we'll be here. We got you, you know. And Jody could have just said, And daughter, get your act together. You know, it is time for you to grow up. You know, she could have spoken truth to her, but it would have been in a way that caused damage and pain. But she did it in such a way that she spoke truth. We're going to make it through this. You can do this. We love you no matter what, you know. And it was such a way that she encouraged and pushed on and said, you can do this, but in such a way that my daughter felt unconditional love, that she knew that no matter what ever happened, you know, mom was going to be there, and dad too. So that's what we need to do. You know, I'm so tempted sometimes to yell at my kids. Any of y'all that have kids, have y'all ever been tempted? I know Tommy had, and Tommy's just the nicest guy I've ever met, but most of us, we just want to say, get your stuff together, Kendrick. You know, I'm just kidding, Kendrick. I would never say, but just get your, you know, but man, we need to do it in a way that they feel loved. Father God, man, the tongue is a powerful thing. The tongue can speak life into people, and the tongue can also speak death into people. It can be like poison, or it can completely change the direction of a ship, the direction of a huge vessel, and the way that it goes, that it ends up in a completely different destination from where it was once started. Lord, that's what we want to do with our tongues. And we want our tongues to line up with you and your purposes. And first and foremost, Lord, we trust you more than we trust ourselves. We want you to be Lord over our life. As James says of his big brother, I am a servant to God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, let us rely on you in that way as well. And Lord, may we guard the things that we believe in our minds. We can hear anything. What we hear should not impact us, but what we know and what we believe are completely different. So as we hear all of these things in the world, Lord, may our faith and trust in you guide us in such a way that what we know and what we believe are what we should be doing. And Lord, help us when we share those words about what we know and we believe. May we do it in such a way that speaks life into people and not death. May we do it in such a way that it joins in with your mission on this earth. It's in Jesus Christ's wonderful and holy name that we can and do pray. Amen. And we're going to close with another song that Lonnie picked out for us today.
I love you more, and I live for more, to worship you, O my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you give. May the sweet, sweet sound in your ear. Oh,
Travis today. We had a really popular worship band, and we closed with a great choir leading us. So just a great experience of worship today. So Father God, as we leave this place, help us see things the way that you see them. Help us see you as you truly are. Help us see ourselves as you see us in the world and those in it in the way that you see them. And let us give us the boldness and the courage to act accordingly. It's in Christ's name that we can and do pray. Amen. Go in peace, everybody.